We'll be right back. Ooh, sorry about that. Hi, my name is Brendan, and this is Accidental Origin, your weekly writing web show. Sorry about that. There was some hardware delays causing some issues with mics and stuff due to the special guest I have today. I am joined by my mod and good friend, MC Pepper Pockets, also known as Sam. I've enabled you, Sam.
Hello. MC Pepper Pockets. Surprise guest, I am a surprise guest. The most toxic way to surprise.
Yeah, pretty much. For those of you who are there, Sam also joined me on my birthday stream last week. So my plan, considering it was drafting week this week, I've gotten a lot of stuff done, working on editing. Unfortunately, I spilled liquid on my notes. They look gross, and I'm gonna have to redo them, because I hate that. Things are going good. So I'm gonna keep editing, and Sam and I are gonna talk about writing and art and random junk, as usual. Plus, I gave him the arduous task of being the moderator for today, so.
There's like at least a million viewers. I can see them right here in the list. Definitely a million.
It's all good, bro. If you build it, they will come.
So I'm going to start this whole thing by saying, be right back.
Really? Ugh. Most unprofessional stream ever. Yeah, pretty much. Pretty much.
Nice. Angle brackets.
I like this setup though with the Gorillapod. I think it's really effective. At Pokemon Go. Is he really quiet? I can turn him up. It's fine. It's always a bit of a task to get that stuff figured out when you first start. Oh. Turned it back on, I guess. Yeah, I want to turn off the autofocus on that camera. Cool. So yeah, oh god. What are you doing, Sam?
I'm fucking with my audio settings. I'm sorry. It's just flailing between plus 10 decibels and plus 50, which is not... I don't know why there's no settings between that.
Weird.
Squeeze microphone. Don't hate on me. Oh, hey, Dronny.
There we go. That's better. I just turned you up in my settings. I have the desktop audio stuff down really low because it sounds super loud in my ears. But,
Oh, I knew it. It wasn't my fault.
No, it wasn't.
There's no way the fact that I spent no time setting this up could probably make it my fault.
Obviously. I got very dramatic lighting going on today. I'm all cool shadows and stuff.
Hey, you just need to angle your camera, like, you know, 10 degrees or something like that. Then we'll really know something exciting is going on.
No, I gotta put it really high up and get that, like, Orwellian, that Orson Welles, like, looking down, like...
Rosebud.
What a great movie. So yeah, what did you want to talk about today, Sam?
I don't know. Well, you know, relevant to your birthday stream, I've been listening to a podcast called Critical Role, which I know probably Terry has recommended to you as well.
Yes.
Which is pretty fantastic. Just 8 voice actors playing D&D, and it is hilarious. It's like the if you had an animator who could live animate this, it would be the greatest cartoon you could ever imagine for adults, not for children. Because there definitely is a lot of talk about troll dick.
Yeah,
I'm gonna plug a already popular podcast.
Yeah, I mean, I'm a big fan of what JP McDaniels does with, like, his role-playing shows. He's got some good people on there that I've known for or watched for a long time, I guess would be a better way to describe it. Hey, Continuity, what's up, man?
Yeah, so I thought their commitment to character, like, even when they're saying things that are probably out of character, they just own it and keep going. So I thought that kind of ability to improvise in the moment, but continue to tell a continuous story is really, really interesting.
Yeah, there's a really good there's like a performance art to it almost, of improvisation and all that kind of stuff. Yes, I agree. Swan Song is the best. And I know you haven't watched it, Sam, but you should, because it's amazing. But yeah, I was going to say, oral storytelling is totally a very different beast than what we do. It's always something that I've wanted to get into, but it's a whole different skill set of performance and things like that.
Yeah, it definitely takes a more like moment-to-moment creativity rather than being able to create like a bigger story.
Yeah. So there is a transition there that I wanted to actually talk to you about, but I forgot. This week, Twitch changed their terms of service. So they're allowing a lot more things, starting with mukbangs. Maybe that was a couple weeks ago.
What was that?
Mukbangs.
Mukbangs. That you should use protection.
Mukbangs are the Korean word for social eating. It's the actual like name of that concept.
Cool. Oh yeah, I saw that, and all I saw was a thumbnail of a man eating the largest bowl of spaghetti.
Yeah, so that's now a thing, and that didn't used to be a thing. But the thing that's important, or the thing that I, yeah, no problem, Continuity, have it going, man. The thing that I kind of take out of that is they've set up a thing for dramatic readings.
Oh, cool!
Yeah,
live audiobooks.
Exactly. And I think they're kind of moving towards... I was talking about this a little bit with Fancy Smanshy TV, who is a friend of... a guy I know on here, I guess. He's a streamer. It's kind of interesting that Twitch has gone from kind of the Justin TV model, and then really, really, like, which was very diverse, and then very much specified as, like, we're going to be a gaming streaming thing. And then now they're diversifying again with a stronger brand and a bigger viewer base, of course. But, yeah, they're diversifying again. It's a really interesting concept.
Well, I mean, that makes a lot of sense, right? You want to focus on what you're good at, which, or at least in this case, what's popular, which is apparently streaming, I don't know, whatever people stream on Twitch for games. But, you know, like, Overwatch or whatever, which is insane right now. But then, like, then you make them add Overwatch dollars and you can just do whatever you want at that point.
Yep. Yeah, use those big things to fund the little things.
Yeah, you know, it's why I sell crack, so I can write. Wait, no, you didn't hear that.
He doesn't actually sell crack. Disclaimer.
Not even to blind kids. It's crazy.
Yeah. But yeah, I'm super interested in this sort of performance, dramatic reading thing.
Yeah, I would love that. I mean, even just some of the ridiculous readings that I've heard of, you know, on the internet, where you'd go to Newgrounds or something back in the day when Newgrounds was a real thing, and there'd just be someone reading hate mail in an incredibly dramatic voice, and it was solid gold. Like, it was always hilarious.
Yeah, I mean, there's a couple things that come to mind for that. Jimmy Kimmel, who I'm not a huge fan of, but I do pay attention to every now and again on YouTube, does a lot of things where celebrities will read hateful tweets towards them.
Yeah, thanks, Obama.
Like, out loud on his show. And yeah, it's kind of weird and funny. But the other thing I was thinking of was something that Question Answered said to me the other day. And it's like, I've been working on this story on stream for, like, what, like 8 weeks? Something like that?
About 1,000 years, yeah.
Give or take. And it'd be really cool to do, like, a dramatic reading of this. Like, when it was all finished, you know? Like, and maybe throw it up on my YouTube or something like that. Like, give it...
That would be cool, actually.
Yeah, it'd be really cool, right? So I was considering that. It'd be hella fun.
You have to get the people that the characters are named after to voice them. So you gotta get Rob to be the president.
Not that story. The on-stream story.
What is this one? Oh, you're doing...
The siren one.
You're doing the siren one.
That would be funny, Rob, though. Would be the siren. I do want Rob to play the president in that, for sure. Yeah.
Don't talk about the non-stream story, oh my god.
Well, it's not that it's not talk about it, it's just more of a, like, people don't have context for that, so it would be very confusing.
It's true, I forgot.
Yeah. So that's...
Quantum leaping.
Yeah, so that's something I'm definitely considering doing.
The next leap will be
the leap home. There was one thing I wanted to ask you about as well. There's always one thing. There's always only one thing I want to ask you about, and it's always 1,000 things.
Mm-hmm.
But
that does happen.
Mm-hmm. Because of my success this week with, like, the 12 to 3 o'clock time slot, and this goes for you as well, stream. I was wondering if maybe that would be a better time slot for me. It does break up my Sundays a little bit more. That being said, I mean, I don't really plan things on Sundays all that much anyway. Because I don't have Sunday nights to do stuff. So maybe that would be a better thing. I think the next couple episodes I'll still do it this time slot, but I was just wondering what people thought about that. Because I kind of liked it. I kind of liked that, like, sort of, like, lunch stream.
Yeah, I think that's not too bad. It's still, like, because it's Sunday, it's relatively easy to catch. I mean, obviously, time zone-wise, that's going to be a little different than your current one, but...
I think time zone-wise, like, Australia gets boned, but everywhere else is pretty okay, because it's, like, 8 in the afternoon. Like, it ends at 8 in the afternoon, 8 in the evening in Europe, in parts of Europe.
Yeah, then that's probably good. And, you know, fuck kangaroos.
Yeah. It's something I'm thinking about. I haven't changed it. Yeah, you'd like that, Johnny? Yeah, you wouldn't have to stay up super late. Not that I'm forcing you to do that, but you do that a lot more than you should. But yeah, there's also a couple of cool writing people that stream late on Sundays as well. And I kind of would like to catch their streams more. And that would allow me to do that and kind of give us both our own space. Because I'm fairly easy. My schedule is very open. And I like that slot. Like, I did that all week this week, and it was good. I liked it. So, yeah, it was something I'm considering. And feel free to let me know your thoughts on that stream. Chat, whoever's listening in the void of time and space.
Hello from the future of YouTube, or the past, or something.
Some other time that is not now. So yeah, what do you think about, I've been thinking about it a lot, because we've been playing VR together, but I really, really want to do a VR visual novel.
I think there's a lot to be done there. Definitely from what I've done and experienced in VR, the storytelling aspect is really, I think, a lot easier than, like, 2D video games, because there's so many environmental clues that you can lay out that just kind of naturally draw you along.
Yeah, for sure.
Not that that can't be done in a regular video game. I mean, Gone Home obviously really does things visually and draws you into that narrative.
I make
very naturally without having to have glowing arrows or anything.
So the interesting thing I thought about that, and for those of you who don't know, Gone Home is a very cool narrative game, which I very much recommend on Steam. I think that's a VR game.
I think it would translate,
like, it's
pretty much one to one.
Yeah, it's like a VR game that came out like a little bit too early, so it's still in 2D.
Yeah, you know what? It reminded me of holodeck games from Star Trek, as crazy as that seems, where it's like you just are in this environment and people act like normal people, and you suddenly, by interacting in that world, there's story that you discover. And
yeah,
it's not like you get an objective marker that says, go and find the truth.
Well, exactly. Like, it... Yeah, exactly. But I think the way it's built and the way that you interact with objects and all that stuff, like, it's very much a VR style game. Like, you have that first person point of view, like, thing.
Yeah. That, and I think that environment would also really benefit from hand presence.
Yeah.
Being able to interact just by touching stuff, opening drawers, pushing doors and stuff like that.
For sure, and I think there's subtle references in there that you'd be able to see better with the ability to kind of, like, actually look around.
Yeah, I'd be able to get down and, like, look under the bed, see the mess that's under the bed.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, there's all sorts of opportunities for that. And it would also add a sense, well, I don't know how well it would do it, but I know, like, if I'm in my parents' house, there's a lot of stairs, and so, you know, running up and down those stairs all the time, you sort of You get those tired legs, which I totally think you could do in VR. You can get that feeling of running up and down from the basement to the ground floor 100 times.
That's an interesting concept to me, because how do you simulate stairs in VR?
I don't know. They haven't done it properly yet, as far as I can tell. There's a lot of teleporting, and I think teleporting up and down stairs is one of the most disorienting things in any of these VR systems.
Yeah.
Because suddenly you're at your different spot on, like, the Z-axis, and I don't know. It's weird.
I like the teleporting thing. It's when you don't have a huge space, it works well to move you around. But I agree with you. It gets weird. Especially the ones that are dashes. Dashes are disorienting at times. Whereas the blink,
yeah,
the blink works better.
A natural movement problem.
Yeah, which is all I think is going to be a constant problem until you can actually move your body and make things move with you.
Yeah, and I know there's people working on redirected walking, where you subtly distort the projection of the environment that the person is perceiving, and that will compel them to kind of walk continuously in a left-hand circle, maybe, where they think they're walking in a straight line. So you can create the sensation of a much larger environment without actually having a larger environment.
Yeah. Yeah, like directing the eye just a little bit. The other thing I was thinking was, it'd be cool if you could do like leans. Like if you lean forward, it would move you forward, and if you lean back, it would move you back, sort of thing. But that might get really weird.
I don't know if that would be great. I know that. I think the PlayStation Move does that with the camera, where you have to kind of lean forward and lift one foot just a little bit to move forward. And guess what? Standing on foot for an hour is not great.
Yeah. That makes sense.
There's definitely something that you can do there with body language. I definitely, body language is one of the biggest positives to VR, even when you just have head and hand presence. I mean, when we were playing Raw Data, you just hold up one hand, and the person knows it's a high five, and then you can do it, and even though there's no haptic feedback, you know what's going on.
Yeah,
you're celebrating your victory.
That was super funny. Though that
was great.
That reload thing was ridiculous. Where we kept stealing each other's ammo?
Oh, yeah. That was weird. I didn't even notice that.
That was super weird.
I did
weird.
Not even notice until you said it, and then it's like, oh, that's why I have no
I was
ammo
like, why do I have to keep reloading my gun? I take, like, two shots and have to reload and be like, what the hell?
Well, that's another thing that they're going to have to resolve, which is collision. Because we were, like, intersecting. We were standing in the exact same spot.
Yeah. I agree with that.
But that's always been an issue with video games, you know, non-real space. Even going back to, like, the original Doom and Quake, there's all sorts of problems with collision. And that's only a matter of time. We're first-generation consumer hardware.
Yeah.
And software is easy to update, at least, so that's something that they can patch in.
That's actually a good point, Ronnie. It'd be really cool if they made, like, VR shoes that had buttons in them.
VR shoes. Yeah, no, that would, yeah.
Like that
absolutely.
you could kind of like shift around in to give you like momentum in different directions or something. I don't know. It'd
they
be neat.
Totally use the same of resistance detection that they use in the VR gloves, where when you bend your fingers, it can tell how bent they are. You could put that in the sole of the shoe and have, you know, when as you lift your heel and you're just on the ball of your feet, you know, that could be a signal to move forward, like take a step without actually having to stand there with your leg out for an hour.
Yep. Yeah, that's interesting. I'm not an engineer, though.
Well, the best way to inspire engineers is to speculate crazily in ways that are clearly impossible, have them tell you how wrong that is, and then they'll go and fix it.
Yeah, exactly. I'm not even being sarcastic about that. I actually, like, that's kind of how things get made.
Yeah, I mean, that's why we had flip phones, because some nerd 50 years ago saw Star Trek and said, shit, I want to flip my phone open and talk to orbit. Well, guess what? I had a phone like that, and now we have a phone way better than that.
Yep. But, you know, like, people work on cool ideas from stories. Like, there are people who do that. Right? Like, scientists who do that.
Of course, yeah. I mean, that's one of the biggest, I think, inspirations for people to go into those STEM fields, is seeing cool things and wanting to make them real.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I guess we were talking about this ourselves a while back, but, you know, VR getting started in computer science labs. You know, like, VR has existed for 20 years, but it hasn't been commercially feasible at all until recently. Right?
Yeah, no, that's a collection of technology developments. I mean, that's actually cell phones that have really spurred it forward, the whole hyper miniaturized accelerometers and really small efficient processors.
Yep.
And really high resolution small screens. So, you know, that's just a function of having the technology to actually do it. Whereas in the late 80s and early 90s, while you could theoretically do it, or like you could do it in a lab, it was janky and, you know, you had to have a bucket because someone was going to puke.
Yeah. Well, exactly. The other thing I was thinking about with that is high frame rate screens.
Yeah, actually, that's a huge component of it.
Yeah, because those are fairly new, like, not super new, but they haven't really been a thing until a couple years ago that we really had very, very good high refresh rate screens. Like, above 60.
Yeah, because, absolutely, having that that floor of 90 FPS is really, really important for the current generation of VR headsets. Or for any of the head-mounted displays in general, even if it's not a 3D one.
Yeah.
For whatever reason, that is, like, the minimum that the human eye needs to think that it's close to being real. And not just some slideshow that's gonna, you know, cause your inner ear to lose its mind.
Yeah. Yeah, and it's really interesting how easy it is to get immersed by a cartoon world.
Yeah, in my experience, honestly, the more cartoony it is, the easier it is. And maybe that's just because of the relatively low resolution right now.
Yeah, I was thinking that. Because we were playing Raw Data, and Raw Data is fairly realistic in its depiction of a lot of things. But I felt like the hand models were kind of meh. Like, it didn't...
That's weird. I had the exact opposite reaction, like, wow, these are cool and real, because I'm so used to those Mickey Mouse gloves.
Well, it was when I first saw them, but then when we were playing together, I was just like, this isn't as good as I wanted it to be.
Yeah, there are some problems with, like, the way they try to emulate your forearm and arm movement, you know, even though it's not tracked.
It was also because the gun was actually in my leg, which was really weird.
Like your holster?
Yeah. Like, it was strapped to, like, inside my thigh. Like, not the inner side of my thigh, like, inside my leg, like, where my leg would be.
It's just a subtle hint from Raw Data that maybe you need to lose some weight. You're so fat, your gun's inside your body, Brendan.
Well,
you eat it?
Well, it wasn't an issue because you can grab it, like, from a little bit away and it's fine, but it was a little weird.
This is like a whole new meaning to eat a bullet.
Nice.
But yeah, no, you're right. The fact that it can't detect where any of your body is except for these external devices makes it really hard to sort of generalize a human form.
Yeah, and I don't know if you got the same experience, but when I was looking at you, like, your arms were like this.
Hold on, I gotta wait. I gotta wait to see what you mean. Oh, yeah, it's because I'm a Tyrannosaurus Rex.
But yeah, I mean, like your model was moving around like this all the time, and I was like, that looks super weird.
That's what I was standing like. You didn't know that? I have only just hands connected directly to the front of my chest.
Obviously.
That Velociraptor emote is all after me.
Gotcha. I found an interesting writing tool today. I found an interesting writing tool today called AutoCritique. And it gave me a huge breakdown of like the different types of language I was using in my story.
In what sense?
It gives you like word frequencies, indicators of passive voice, adverbs, dialogue tags, generic descriptions, cliches, how much you like your frequency compared to basically general published fiction of like the verb look, the verb maybe, had, have, was, were, could, that kind of stuff.
Okay, yeah, that could be definitely very interesting.
It's super useful.
I always find word frequency breakdowns interesting, if not necessarily immediately useful, but just being able to see, like, oh, I use this adjective a lot. You know, then you can go through and take a bunch of them out.
Yeah, that's definitely an indicator. The one that was super interesting to me was that I used the word that 26 times.
Never use the word that.
Exactly.
Period.
There are a couple situations. There are a couple in there where that refers to a specific like a specific thing, like that guy or that house, in which it's okay. But yeah, there's quite a few that I just straight up cut. Where I was like, this doesn't need to be here.
Sorry, I'm just tormenting right here for a second.
Yeah, I see that. But it's interesting because I've been kind of, like, as a part of this editing process, I've been looking a lot at my word choices and how I write and how complex I write and stronger words, like, things like that.
And this is maybe not, something that tool does, but... And I don't necessarily think about this consciously when I'm writing, but I always think in English it's really interesting because we have so many different root languages, because we have so many different people came and added their words to our vocabulary. So in English, often the fancier words or words that we perceive as being fancier are derived from French or Latin, whereas the more simple or forceful words tend to come from German. Or Germanic languages, at least.
That makes sense.
So you can totally take a Latinate-sounding word and you know, like, switch it out for a Germanic-based word, even because there'll be definitely an equivalent there. So you can change your tone and feeling of it by flipping to just a synonym from a different origin.
That's super interesting.
I don't know. I've never tried that.
No, that makes perfect sense to me. As someone who spent a little bit of time learning languages, I mean, I studied French in school, a little bit of German, and, like, looked at, like, Asian languages in general from my manga and all that kind of stuff there. But, yeah, that makes total sense to me. There's a lot of... Like, English is primarily a Germanic language, but there's a lot of words taken from the Romance languages, for sure.
Yeah, I mean, grammatically, it's definitely more German, but vocabulary wise, we pretty much fully anglicized a huge swathe of French words.
Oh yeah, there's a ton of French words that are used today in English.
Yeah, like, I mean, at work, they want us to use... The official font is sans serif. So there's a French word right there that we just use, like, every day in typography.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, totally. Well, I was thinking... Well, I've been thinking about Evo a lot because I've been watching that this weekend. But Super Smash Bros. Melee, from the word melee in French, right?
Yeah, drawn from Super Smash Brothers Melee. You shortened it down during the Norman Conquest just to Melee.
Yeah. Yeah, there's a ton, right?
Yeah, it's all over the place.
Clarity is from a French word.
But, I mean, there's also a lot... Because of the influence of... Sorry, I'm trying to read your thing at a weird angle here. There's a lot of... Yeah, pardon me, is French. Wow, what was I saying? There's a lot of Greek words, too. Because there's so much cultural baggage there.
There's a ton of European. Cultural baggage, yeah. From Greek.
Cultural
sure.
Baggage.
Blah, blah, blah. Yeah, totally. Because of the Renaissance and a lot of that stuff, right?
Well, yeah, definitely. And actually, it's funny that you mentioned the Renaissance because in a lot of ways, the Western European Renaissance was spurred by 1453 when the Ottomans finally rolled over Constantinople. There was a huge... And that was the last part of the Eastern Roman Empire. Basically, the Greek Roman Empire, as stupid as that sounds. And there was a lot of refugees, intellectuals, who escaped to the West. And they went to Paris and Rome and Venice and London. And, you know, they settled in and they had all these old Greek works, translations from all sorts of things. And that brought a lot of historical knowledge and technical knowledge to the West that had been lost or suppressed or just hadn't been implemented.
Yeah. Totally.
Yeah, so, I mean, and that, again, is just another migration, right? People moving from one place to another, bringing new words and new ideas, and those things, the ones that are useful or popular, just getting taken wholesale.
Yeah.
And used.
And Johnny brings up a good point about English words... being used in German and meaning different things. That happens a lot in Korean and Japan as well. In Korea and Japan as well. Things like handy.
You want to be careful how you use the word handy in English.
Yeah.
Don't just give someone a handy.
Well, I was going to say, because in Korean, cell phone is a handphone. The inflection's a little different, but it's basically that pronunciation.
Well, it makes sense.
Yeah. So the one thing I did want to talk to you, because I'm totally using your history major here against you, but the thing that a lot of people don't know is that the English monarchy spoke French predominantly for a significant period of time.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, most of the English monarchs didn't speak any English until... I don't even know if I could tell you when, like probably the 1600s. It was, like, in their normal life. Well, no, maybe...
Hey, Erica, what's up? Aren't you supposed to be streaming right now?
Maybe only the 1500s. But still.
Yeah.
That's another English import thing. Like, the monarchy got imported, imported itself, to the British Isles with the Norman Conquest. And then... Even later, when it ended up being what was the German family that inherited the throne? Saxe-Coburg-Gotha, I think is how it's pronounced. They spoke German. They did not speak English. You know, they inherited the throne, and it was just a language change, and now everyone had to learn German.
Yeah, that's basically the way it worked, right? That sounds awesome, Erica.
Yeah, well,
I'm really glad it went well. That is something I want to do at some point.
Did our stream go well? That would be nice.
Yeah,
that would
be awesome. Oh, I totally thought that you said you were streaming at 7 p.m. Anyway, it's fine. It's all good. I'm glad it went well. I would have came though. I didn't know you were streaming. Oh well. Not much I can do about it now. Let's actually use bot commands that I have set up. That'd be cool, right? Oh, I spelled it wrong. I'm sorry. I totally spelled that wrong. It's trying so hard. There we go. I got it.
Amateur hour.
Man. You know, this is the eighth day in a row I've streamed.
Yeah, you should be getting good at this point.
You'd think. This is definitely telling, not showing.
Actually, that's been something, the whole telling versus showing thing has been something I've been thinking a lot, because I've been reading a book called The Dark Forest, which is the second book in a series by this Chinese author, Shishen Lu. It's the Three Body Problem books.
Yeah.
The third one, translation, is just coming out, I think, in September or October. And they're really good. But the way that author works a lot of the time is he will set up and describe how his characters plan to do things or what they think is going to happen, their projections. And then he'll essentially just say, and then it happened. And then he'll move, you know, past that. So if it's not actually relevant, if you don't really need to hear it, he'll just say, yeah, well, then they did it.
That's actually,
which I think is really interesting.
It's good writing. I've read a lot of articles. Well, I've read a few articles. Let's not pretend I've read thousands of things. I've read a few articles about stuff like that, where narrative summary is an important tool to use. The idea of summarizing a series of activities that aren't important.
Yeah, I think it's really interesting because it flies in the face of show don't tell, because you know sometimes I guess if it doesn't matter you can just tell the reader.
Yeah,
they don't really need to be shown.
Oh yeah, for sure. It's harder to do that in a short story.
Yes,
because you shouldn't really be you shouldn't really have enough little bits like that in order to cut out. Like you shouldn't have it more. Oh god, that sentence makes no sense. You shouldn't have a significant. What am I
Is
trying to say, Sam?
Wanted to do be more like. I think you're trying to say you shouldn't even include those things in a short story.
You shouldn't have enough narrative space to include them.
Yeah, like if you don't need it in a short story, you should just take it out. Whereas in a novel, there is definitely details that can be backgrounded sufficiently that you don't need to be immediately present for every moment-to-moment piece of action.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, totally.
A short story, yeah. You should be right there.
Exactly.
Hold on one second. I'll be right back.
Okay. So, yeah. Oh, yeah, I forgot. I meant to... Thanks for the host, Mishmash. I apologize it took me this long to get back to you. I got distracted at the time. And I'm not very good with distractions. These boots, man. These boots.
These boots?
Yeah.
These were they made for walking?
Maybe. I feel bad though, because it would be the only one of the 15 prompts that I actually cut.
Boots?
Yeah.
Were boots a specific prompt?
Yeah. There's leather boots.
Hmm.
What do you think?
Why wasn't he sleeping with his boots on?
Because the siren took them off.
He wanted to be... Wait, really? Is this a thing that happened?
Yeah.
Oh, I missed that.
It's something I wrote, yes. That this... Anyway. It happened while he was unconscious. It's a thing.
Is this just so he can, like, get up and Captain Kirk sitting on the edge of the bed pulling his boots on?
It was a bench, but yes.
Still.
It was actually only because I wanted to include the boots in some way. Which probably means I should get rid of it.
He would probably be wearing sandals. This is a Greek hero.
I mean, you're right.
That's why there are swords and sandals movies.
Yes. Which are all filmed in Italy.
Yes, kinky siren. This siren likes feet. It's weird. It's not weird.
Yeah. Sword and sandals.
She sings and you just take your shoes off.
I was talking about that yesterday. About how I wanted to play the song. Like, how did I want to represent the song in the story?
Just a bunch of hashtags.
Just a bunch of hashtags.
Yeah, just hashtags.
Yeah. Thanks, Ryan. Yeah. It's weird, right?
Well, yeah, I mean, do you want to do lyrics? Is this creature singing words, or is it just a sound? Like, is it just something that the character hears?
Yeah. So, I can show you, actually. God, I hate it when I get... junk on stuff. It's the worst. Where'd it go? Oh, here we go. Right here, see those two green things? That's the song. And it's,
see the green things.
Yeah, it's kind of like weird, like commands almost, but I don't think it's very representative of what the song actually is and what I'm trying to do with the song.
Yeah, that looks weird.
It does, right? I don't hate it, but I don't love it.
No, it doesn't look natural in the text. It should just be dialogue there, and then you should have some description, I feel like, after it. And yeah, you should stop killing so many trees, Brendan. Why do you hate nature?
Because nature hates me.
Hmm.
Yeah, I'm thinking about it because I want... So, when I was reading the mythology of sirens... The thing that stuck out to me was that the siren song was described as sweet as it is sad. And that really goes well with the sort of transformed, fallen comrade sort of style thing that I've got going on with the siren. Where, you know, they were the handmaidens of Persephone.
I don't know if you pronounce it quite like that, but all right.
Whatever.
I'll allow it.
Yeah, so they got changed by Demeter as a punishment slash like search party thing. So I want that sort of sense of I like that sense of sadness, but it's also got a it's seductive, right? It's sweet and sad, but not melancholic or bitter.
Yeah, it has to be irresistible, an irresistible call to action to drive yourself onto these rocks. Or, I suppose it could be so sad that that is all that you can do.
Yeah. So I'm considering what I want to do with that song still, but yeah, I think I need, I did this cool thing, several times in this story where I kind of just like flashed emotions like really quick. And I'm kind of wondering if I want to do something like that for the song. Like just a quick flash of emotions in his head.
I think that could work. It'd be show more the result than the action.
Yeah. I usually do print both sides, Johnny. I didn't for this specifically because trying to edit double-sided on stream doesn't work. Does not work very well. And that's the other thing too is having the voice commands and all that was weird, but it kind of made sense because music is very subjective. So what you hear might not be what someone else hears. Right? Like it gets weird.
That could be something you could play with. If you had more than one character here listening to that, they could each be perceiving something different. And, you know, that's something you could explore between those two characters.
For sure, but that actually brings up the idea of I could show something about his character through what he sees.
Yep, definitely. He hears, smells, whatever.
Yeah. Use the song to characterize. Like, rather than having a compare contrast, just show things that are about him and not about her.
Well, here's something that you could try. Instead of just describing how he feels, what if each of these moments of song elicited a memory, a sense memory, an emotional memory?
Yeah, I was thinking that too. Like almost like a psychic imprint. Or do you know what I mean by that though?
Yes, yes. Sorry, I'm just seeing I'm imagining the siren singing anything by Linkin Park now. And it's doubly hilarious because I was totally thinking like Nirvana.
Yeah. Yeah. get over it.
I can't. It's the more I imagine it, the funnier it is. Oh god, okay, sorry. I'll get my shit together here.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's a lot of things you could do with that.
Well, that's the thing, Johnny, is it would depend on what you consider to be sweet or sad. It'd be very subjective. Seeing that they're talking about Greek, it probably would be a male voice. Because a lot of, like, artists in that day and age would have been male and not female.
I'm pretty sure they would have considered women incapable of being artists at that point.
I think the Greeks were a little bit less crazy with that stuff. Because, I mean, Sappho was totally a thing, right?
That's true.
But still, yes. I also think Greeks did not have the sort of the female bias of acting. where you basically were only an actor if you were a prostitute, that thing?
I guess so, yeah, that's...
That was a thing in medieval Europe,
those
right?
Those ancient peoples. What? What was?
That whole, like, no respectable woman was an actor, so only street people were actors, basically?
I guess?
That was totally a thing. I'm just trying to remember what time period that was. Well, I mean, Shakespeare didn't have any female actors.
That's true. Yeah, he had a lot of cross-dressing going on in his plays because he didn't have any female actors and he needed to have female characters.
Yep. But he couldn't have female actors. Like, it was against the rules.
Yeah, was
or whatever.
That just because it was, like, illegal?
I think so.
I don't even know.
I think it was illegal. Especially because he was in a proper theater in London, like, and performed for the Queen and stuff. So, like,
that's true.
Yeah, it's a SWAT song.
The SWAT song. Yep. Sad and sweet. Good. It's great and good.
Yeah.
My God, why does Linkin Park have so many albums? Now I've been forced to go look it up. This isn't right.
They've released a couple albums in the last few years.
1,000 albums.
That's a lot of albums. Oh, it's because of all their, they had a bunch of, bootlegs. Not like bootleg, just like bootlegs, but like,
Like pants legs?
No, like, mixtapes.
Oh, yeah. No, it's true. Yep. Apparently they put out just like individual songs. Yeah, that's an album now. Deal with it.
Well, it's cause technically that's a record. And records are albums. Anyway, yeah.
Yeah, the ancient Greeks and Romans weren't really into women's rights, right? Like, they didn't even really care to give women names. For the most part, which is pretty intense.
Well, Helen of Troy.
Yeah, that name I'm pretty sure just meant that Greek lady.
You're probably right, because it would be Hellenic is used to describe Greek, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah,
plus that whole story, I mean, if you actually read it and look at the background of it, Helen of Troy was not an active participant. It was totally Paris and the god messing with him.
Oh, yeah. There's a lot of crazy, crazy shit going on. if you actually read the Iliad.
Yeah, and I mean, I think actually that's that thing with Paris having to choose the most beautiful one. That's the original snub. That's the Discordian, or not... Yeah, the Eresian snub, where Eris isn't considered one of the candidates.
So was it Eris?
Pisses everyone else off.
Or are you thinking of Athena?
Eris is the god of discord, or goddess of discord. Athena, it was... I can't remember exactly the story, but it was...
Eris
had to choose between...
Eris is the god of war. He's male.
No, you're thinking of Ares.
Oh. Oh, sorry, you mean Eris, like E-R-I-S. Yes, okay, my
yes.
bad. Got you. I followed along. I just thought you were pronouncing it funny.
No, Eris, E-R-I-S, is one of the goddesses. Speaking of Eris, they discovered another dwarf planet. Did you see that?
No, I didn't.
They found one out near Neptune. It's in like a hugely elliptical orbit that goes way out into the Oort cloud, and it's like half the size of Pluto.
Cool.
So now there's 26 dwarf planets in the solar system on top of the 8 regular full-size planets.
When you played the lab, did you notice that they didn't include Pluto in their solar system
model? It doesn't dominate its local gravitational region. It's not a planet.
I was really hoping that that simulation would be better, though, because I totally put Jupiter in Mercury's orbit, and nothing happened.
Yeah, the physics in that suck. But what is really neat, and what I did was bring them all really close up to the sun and then try and project the shadow of one over another to see how large they were by comparison. I found that really entertaining.
Fair enough.
Like, you can put all the terrestrial worlds, all the inner planets, in front of Jupiter or even Saturn and not block out even half of its surface area with shadow. Things are real big out there. But actually, that was, speaking of things being real big, that was the number one thing that annoyed me about that, which is that it was so profoundly not to scale.
Yeah, they state it's not to scale on the clipboard.
But it was tough to tell what was to scale, because I think the relative size of the planets was right.
Yeah, they didn't do the distance, because they were like saying, and this is obviously...
Well, you can't.
Yeah, you can't, because it would have taken people hours and days to walk to different planets, which would be no fun.
And yeah, you could either have things be visible, or you could have it be real scale. So if it were full, like a real scale, you'd be able to see the sun as like the size of a coin, and then everything else would just be a single pixel.
Yeah.
Oh, damn!
You burned you good. I'm
called out. Oh, damn it. Gonna pay you. Damn it. Damn you, chat. I'm so owned.
Yeah. So if she's gazing into the fire, how does she see him?
She has eyes in the back of her head, obviously.
She's not a Gorgon.
Maybe she just smells him because he's a Greek and he doesn't shower at this time and period of history. He lives on a boat.
I debate the fact that he's Greek.
Where is he from then? And look at that name, Hypernor.
He was born of dragon's teeth.
What?
Sewn into the ground by Cadmus and founded the city of Thebes.
He's a dragon tooth man? That's no good.
He's a monster.
I thought that was... Yeah, okay, I was gonna say, I thought that was demons that came up when he did that.
No, okay, so the mythology goes
or
that...
dragons.
Well, the mythology of this particular story is Cadmus slew this dragon after getting told by an oracle, as things happen in Greek stories. He gets told by an oracle to go found a city, and he slays a dragon, and he plants half of the dragon's teeth in the soil, and a bunch of warriors spring up and start fighting each other until only 5 are left, and he's one of the 5. Jason, of Jason and the Argonauts fame, planted the rest of the teeth as part of one of his trials to win the Golden Fleece.
So this is clearly a metaphor for, like, the early Eastern Mediterranean cultures that all, like, beat the crap out of each other and only a handful of them survived.
Probably. Not sure how I feel about this no memory thing. It just seems a little odd.
Some sort of ancient Greek memento. He's gonna have to tattoo a picture of a siren on his leg that says, "Don't trust this man or woman."
Oh, actually, you're a good person to ask for this, Sam. What would be a good unit of measure that people, modern people, would understand, but would be culturally appropriate for Greek?
What are you trying to measure?
I'm trying to measure the wingspan of the siren. I wanted to do it in cubits, but I was told cubits aren't very understandable nowadays.
Cubits weird. Cubits are not a good unit. Maybe like arm spans.
I wrote paces as a possible option.
What, are you gonna walk across this bird wings?
Well, no, but you would measure things in paces, like. People would. People do.
Yes. Well, at the... Yeah, I mean, I think they used measurement units a little differently then. Like, you had very specific units for everything.
Okay.
It wasn't really... There was no sense of standardization.
Yeah. Like, what's a league? How long is a league?
A league is the distance. A league is really easy. It's the distance a person can walk in an hour. Leagues are really useful for people who don't want to use units, because it's time times distance, or it's time and distance, I should say.
But then that means that a league is different depending on who's walking it.
It was averaged.
Okay.
But it was usually like 5 kilometers or 2 or 3 miles.
Makes sense. Paces make sense to me too, Logan. Yeah, fingers and heads. Yeah. I do like cubits, but you know.
What if you measured it like a horse, hands across?
That's not a bad call, actually. I hadn't thought of that. That seems really weird, though, that you would know exactly how many hands it is, though. Like, wide. Like,
I don't know,
at
maybe
first glance.
Dude's very good at estimating hands. Maybe he's very...
See, horses handy. Horses make sense to me, because you kind of, if you see enough horses, you can kind of get a baseline. They're a certain number high.
I guess, yeah.
So how do you feel about internal character thoughts?
Sorry, I was looking up how to measure birds, and there's some real weird diagrams on here. Internal character thoughts are really useful in some cases. It totally depends on what your narrative perspective is.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, I feel like you're mainly from this one guy's perspective, so it'd be fine to be inside his head.
The entire story is written from his perspective.
Yeah, so then, but you just gotta be really careful not to ever let anyone else's thoughts bleed into it.
See, I'm not worried about letting other people's thoughts bleed in. I've been having this conversation with Stevie Ray Vaughan about... she hates character thoughts. Like pulling a thought out of someone's head and putting it on the page. Much more of a fan of, like, demonstrating those thoughts through their actions or through their words or whatever. I've been thinking about it.
I feel like people have thoughts. I know there's thoughts inside my head, so to pretend like that a character, a conscious character, isn't having that internal monologue is kind of weird.
Yeah. I just think I might do it too much is the issue.
Well, that's probably true.
Yeah. Like, I have characters ask internal questions a lot, and I think that might be a problem.
Yeah, that's not... I don't think that's a great thing to do. That feels too much like you're... It, you know what that is? It's you asking yourself a question, I think.
That, you're not wrong.
So maybe you should just take that as a prompt to try and explore that particular point a little bit more, and then, you know, take that as what you should be describing.
Yeah. I mean, I hadn't thought of that. That makes perfect sense. And that's kind of what I've been editing out of these last couple of pages, is like, it just seems weird that he has no memory, and it seems weird that he's questioning himself in these ways. It doesn't seem in his character. I think you're right. Like, you're kind of humanizing... I'm humanizing myself as an author and the author's perspective into my characters.
Yeah, so how do you think he should respond then? Like, would he be a more aggressive response to this lack of memory? Like, would he fake it until he can figure it out?
So, the way I've been describing Hyperinor is that... And I know I'm pronouncing it wrong, because it's actually like Hyperinor. Something like that. But... I've kind of classed him as this sort of arrogant guy, but he's not arrogant as in like confidence and skills. He's like arrogant in that like fear me because I'm a monster sort of way.
Okay. Like he knows he's untouchable, or he wants to project an untouchable perception.
So here's the part that makes it interesting is his monstrosity is the part that he hates most about himself.
Okay, so then he's almost become obsessed with it.
Like, he's almost outwardly projecting his own internal struggle and forcing people to conform to him because of it.
Yeah, he has one... He's seen how people react, and he knows how to control that. And so he tries to, like, maintain it because of what he knows.
Yeah, exactly. So then, you know, how does he react when he has no memory of what just happened? Like, is he...
Well, that's,
I know, it's my question. It's just... I'm thinking aloud. But yeah, like... Is he... scared? Because there's something that isn't scared of him? Is he... like, is he surprised because he didn't think it could happen?
How does the character react to fear? Right? Like,
well, I think with his arrogance, the way that I would like to portray him, or I'm thinking of portraying him, is that if he's scared of something, he just needs to be more monstrous and make them more afraid of him than he is of them.
So his reaction to fear is more aggression.
Yeah.
Yeah, so just make him, you know, come at me, bro, kind of scenario.
Yeah, I mean, that makes sense. And that's what makes this confrontation interesting, because it's a monster who slays monsters confronting a monster who doesn't want to slay monsters and doesn't want to be slain and has power.
Wait a minute, you're accidentally writing a Witcher story.
Am I?
Yes.
Are you sure it's by accident?
That's exactly Geralt of Rivia.
I mean, you're not wrong. I don't portray
Cherry
this.
Of Rivertown.
Jerry of Rivertown. Yeah.
You Jerry, you want to go slay some demons?
I think. Sorry, I was just gonna catch up with Chad a bit there. I think that's true, Logan. I think it does depend. I definitely think that I'm projecting too much, though. I think I ask existential questions because I think I'm because I think I'm clever, and I want the reader to think I'm clever, and it happens. I'm trying to be better about it. Is that Latin?
Yes.
Well, he doesn't speak Latin, so you're wrong.
Whatever. Still valid.
I actually didn't even think of The Witcher at all when I was writing this. So it surprises me that you make that connection, but it makes logical sense.
Well,
you're also the guy in my life who likes to say, "Oh, this is like that thing I read." It's like, okay, Sam.
I know. Everything always reminds me of something else.
It's okay, I'm that person for other people, so it's fine, but I'm just saying, like, you're that guy in my life. It's okay, there's always connections.
The physical incarnation of, that's like that book.
we're always kind of subconsciously building upon the things that we've seen, our experiences with, and what we've read. So, I mean, that makes sense. Like, I like that theme. I like the theme of what it means to be a monster. And exploring that theme. And I've never really done it, surprisingly enough, despite how much I actually really like movies and books about that. I've never actually done it myself. So this is the first time. I think it's a little less... I think it's a little less Geralt and a little bit more like Hercules in a way.
Oh, but Hercules was a monster too.
He was, exactly. Like, that's kind of my point, and that's the whole idea of the Trials of Hercules, right? Where he was drugged into a craze and murdered his wife and son. Like, he's not exactly a poster boy.
Yeah, it was definitely... But that was kind of a stop hitting yourself scenario by the gods.
Yeah.
So, I mean, that wasn't exactly fair, but... And this, I mean, this isn't totally... totally different, really.
Yeah. This is not correct. Well, of course he had. Why is this even a question? So, I actually wrote the entirety of this scene before I started editing it, which is the first time in a while for me, because of the way that I like to work, right?
Yeah.
It feels very different. it's kind of a unique, it's not unique experience, but I can see the beginning and the end, and I know where all the twists are, so I kind of am shaping things in certain ways.
Yeah, welcome to my world.
Yeah, it's interesting.
Yeah, it produces a very different result. Well, process and result.
Yeah. I'm not sure that I want to write this way every single time, but I think that I need to adopt a larger stance on it. Whereas instead of doing as many iterations as I used to do, that maybe I should write an entire scene, like beginning to end, and then look back over it, sort of thing. Like, not
yeah,
do as many small parts.
You're kind of, I feel like, over micromanaging your story when you can leave a lot of it to its own devices, kind of.
I could see that. My sort of limited success and productivity forcing me to be overly management of my process. I could see it. Because I was thinking about it, and this story is actually over 3,000 words long. So this week, this story is so much closer than Dinner, which is the story I'm working on off stream, which I've been working on since February. Like this, I spent so much less time on this, and it's much closer, I think, to completion in a lot of ways. Maybe not an actual drafting. Testament.
Yeah, it's a testament to actually putting stuff down on paper. If you can't write the words down, you're not going to get it done.
Well, for sure, Logan. Yeah, but...
Yeah.
And I do that, and I know that, and I write like that. It's just more of a... What's a good way to describe it? It's like I work on it kind of like in small stages so that I can be more productive and complete things more often. I suppose it's had not as much success as I would like, but it's had more success than I've had in the past. I'm still working on my process. It's a constant process to work on your process. But I'm learning a lot. I'm learning a lot about the type of stories I'm trying to tell and how I'm telling them. So as much as that's not necessarily been as quick to completion as I would like, it's very much helped me learn as a writer. Like how I write, the style that I want to write in, what am I trying, like, am I trying to be literary? Am I trying to say something? Like, what am I doing as a writer, as an author? So yeah, it's different, right? And of course, being someone who works, like I studied screenwriting, I would do comic work, like I've worked in a bunch of different mediums, and that process has changed. Like working on those other things has changed the sort of way I think about even writing prose. No, Jarani, I didn't forget. I was gonna take a break now. I've gotten so used to like not really taking breaks or taking few breaks. And not having to talk the entire time has made this much easier for me. So that's awesome. But yeah, I'm going to take a 4 to 5 minute break, and we'll be back after that with more of, well, this, whatever this is. Okay, and we're coming back. I feel like I missed a step here. I jumped from this sort of like thing to them introducing themselves. And I agree with you about the more aggression.
Yeah, this guy seems like if he saw something he couldn't immediately identify, his sword's gonna come out immediately.
Yeah. You think, Troy? I think
that's what it always feels like.
Yeah, I think that's how it always feels like, and Logan agrees. It just how it is.
Maybe this is the best way to create time travel. Just edit. If the more intensely you edit, the further back in time you'll go. Time will slow down so much it just reverses.
Think about it this way, Droney. Those thumbnails you were working on, these are my thumbnails. So now I'm using all that feedback that people gave me, and mostly I gave myself, and now I'm actually making real things out of it. Well, sure, but it's knowing when something is good enough. That's kind of the skill, right? I don't know, Johnny. I think you should just kind of let that llama sit as it is and work on another one. Maybe a llama tank. No, I'm not Jonah. Yeah. So, I guess my next question is, Sam. It's very, well, I don't know if it's a question, I guess. It's a comment that will spark discussion, I hope. But how do you deal with that sense of being the author and knowing everything? Where you're writing a scene and you're moving along and suddenly a character is a little bit off, like they know something's going to happen. Like in that way where actors
react
a little bit too quick, or they react a little bit too oddly because they know something is going to happen to them despite how hard they're trying to act like they don't.
Do you know everything that happens in your story? Holy crap, I totally don't.
This story, yes, pretty much.
Well, you gotta kind of distance yourself from it a little bit, I feel like. I try and let my characters explore things themselves a lot, and then, you know, let that define them, rather than me trying to know everything that they are. Like, they inform me more than I inform them, I think.
Yeah, I've heard that, I've heard that opinion discussed a lot, and sort of that let the characters do their thing and you're just along for the ride and not knowing and all that stuff. And I'm not against that. I'm noticing little bits in here where I've done that. Like this moment here where he's kind of like, I was supposed to do this. Like, he's already relinquished his goal. But he hasn't been convinced to relinquish his goal. He's just kind of done it. That being said, I was kind of going for this thing where we don't know if the siren brainwashed him or not. But I don't think that communicates very well right now, as of right now.
No. But that's tough, because, I mean, that's, you're getting into unreliable narrator territory.
Gardener versus architect. That's really cool.
Yeah.
Because I totally take the architect route. I am a master planner.
I think the best way, or the best possible way, is probably somewhere in between there. But yeah, it's very much depends on your preference there and on your personal style.
Yeah, well, we've already established that I'm way too much of a micromanager when it comes to this stuff, probably.
Well, as long as it comes out to something, you know, usable.
I think it comes also from knowing a lot more about, my plot and my structure and my idea than about the characters themselves. Which I guess in and of itself is a problem.
Maybe, but in a different light, that could be extremely good, because you have created the environment through which you're going to pass these characters, and then they can react naturally to that.
Yeah. Though I suppose the opposite is also true. Where
absolutely.
The characters are too controlled because I don't allow them to act naturally, I just react them how I think they should react.
Yeah, you're reacting like you're puppeteering these people, and you need to make them dance, but you don't necessarily have to do that. Like, if you prod them, they're going to react on their own. And if they don't, it's going to feel really unnatural, and so you're going to have to change that to make them react in a natural way anyway. So it kind of, it's self-sustaining, almost.
Well, almost self-defeating, really.
Sort of.
Well, I guess the way I look at it is, if you've spent all this effort making them do the thing you want, and then when you edit, knowing that you'll have to change them because they're not going to be good, you might as well have just done them good in the first place.
Well, but that's the whole point, right? You're iterating. You didn't know that before. Writing the first draft was what informed you of that new information.
Yeah. Yeah, and I do that, Drowny. I do make character sheets. I don't do it as much as I probably should. But my problem with character sheets is, as much as I know how important every detail on those sheets are, I don't care about certain things. And I mean, maybe that's my fundamental problem of, I need to care about the details I don't think matter in order to inform my characters better. But also, maybe I just need to adopt a better character style that more suits what I want to do, while giving me enough information to have those things that will inform the character. I know. What do you think about that, Sam?
Sorry, what? I was looking away for a second.
What kind of moderator? I'm gonna ban you.
Not a good moderator. Make a character sheet.
Yeah, I was saying how I don't like using character sheets as much as I probably should, because there's a lot of details on them that I don't care about. And I was saying that that might be a fundamental problem with me, but maybe I should figure out a way of doing a character sheet that will have the information I want, as well as information that I can use to inform the character without seeming annoying or boring or whatever. I guess maybe I'm just being a dreamer and that doesn't exist, but...
What if, I mean, the way I do it is almost the opposite way. I'll have the sheet and that's just like my record of what this character has done or said or thought, rather than it operating as the borders of what that character is. I'm like working from the inside out.
Yeah, I don't know if you've ever looked at it, but oh god, I'm going to totally forget her name, as even though I love it so much. Holly. Give me a sec.
Yeah, I definitely feel like putting everything that you can think of in, and then kind of carving off the bits that don't need to be there. And even then, like, you know that that could have been a scene. It's just not one that's within the scope of the story you're telling right now.
Yeah. I mean, I'm literally doing that in this. I deleted more than half the scenes I originally planned because I decided that they weren't interesting to the story. But I used those scenes to inform the story of what was going on in the background that we don't necessarily see. So I'm thinking of Holly Lizzle? Lyle? Oh god, I can't pronounce this. Oh, never heard it pronounced. Anyway, she's a writer. She's written a ton of novels. No one's ever read her books. Except, she's written a bunch of really, really awesome books on writing. Specifically fantasy writing and world building and that kind of stuff. And her idea is that you have a binder, and the binder is divided into specific sections of like culture, clothing, activities, whatever. And every time you add something to the story, you toss another page in the binder with that detail, like a living record, so you can reference it later if you need to.
Yeah, that makes sense. That's just an extension of write down everything.
Yeah, well, I'm just saying, like, it was that she has a specific organizational pattern and describes it in great detail in her book. Interesting. What software do you use, Logan? Are you just like you just use like Microsoft Word or something, and then have like separate bio files, or are you just using character.txt as an example? And I agree with that, and I probably need to do stuff like that more. I was just thinking. I guess I'm too much of a planner. I need to know things. Because otherwise I get caught in these deep ruts of, like, not doing anything. That being said, there are people who plan a lot more than me. I feel like I'm somewhere in the middle ground of the spectrum. Because I like having a clear idea, but not necessarily knowing every detail. There are some people, some authors, and I've read books by them, writing books by them, where they're like, yeah, no, we plan everything. Down to the scene, characters, like, and I was like, that sounds annoying. Difficult.
Yeah, they know, like, the brand of socks that their characters are wearing. Stuff that you would never possibly ever encounter.
I found this awesome character profile thing that has 400 questions on it.
That seems like too many questions.
I don't even know what you could ask in 400 questions. Like, what would you even ask about?
You could ask everything. Like, what is their favorite piece of music? What is their favorite book? You're never going to discuss literature with these characters, and it's never going to come up. But knowing what their particular taste is could somehow, I guess, inform some decision, I guess.
I respect the hell out of that, Logan. I actually enjoy writing in Notepad a lot more than I thought I would. I've been using it a lot lately because the computers I have access to at work don't necessarily have any word processing software. For the few times I actually get to do things at work, which is not often. But I love Scrivener. I use Scrivener for everything. And Scrivener is awesome where it allows you to have that sort of character file off to the side and you can just throw things in there.
Yeah, worried about Scrivener is you can do that and have it write up at the same time.
Yeah.
In the same piece of software.
I figured out that you can lock windows the other day, and it was like mind-blowingly awesome.
What do you mean you can lock windows?
You can lock windows so that they don't change. So you can have like your draft open and lock it, and then you can whatever you click on in the menu will only go to the second window.
Oh.
Which is super useful if you're doing a specific thing.
I'm locking something right now. What am I doing? What does this mean? It's all red. My God.
Yeah.
My God, what a brave new world of text editing this is.
Like, just discovering all those little bits.
What is this?
Yeah, you missed... You weren't there for pretty much most of the week because you were at work, but...
Yeah, I have to work for a living. Not all of us can just take... whatever.
Yeah. If you can use the keywords... there's a keywords bar, and you can just put things in it, and you can literally, like... put characters' names in it and just drag them onto your page whenever you need them. Which is super awesome when you have crazy Greek spellings.
I see, yeah. So you only have to type it once.
Yeah. it's under Control-Shift-O.
No. Oh my God, yeah, and you can just dump it right in the text. That's bizarre.
Yeah.
Hmm. I don't know when exactly I'd use that myself, but I'm sure I will eventually.
It's come in handy quite a few times this week. Mostly because, like I said, crazy Greek spelling.
Oh, how did we meet? What a romantic story that is.
Do you want to tell the story? I'm cool if you tell the story.
I'm pretty sure the story is just we worked at the same place.
That's
got arbitrarily assigned to the same area, and we worked together, and that was it. It was just pure chance.
Yep, that's pretty much how it went.
Yeah, that's actually, that's even kind of an interesting character point. Not everything has to be by design.
Yeah.
Things just get smashed together a lot of the time in real life. But that can be difficult from a narrative perspective, because as a reader, you want, and even as a writer, you want things to be there for a reason.
Yeah.
Having something that's just there and does nothing is distracting and sometimes frustrating. It's a Chekhov's gun kind of problem.
Yeah, exactly. I was discussing that yesterday as well. Where you have a lot of editorial control, and sometimes it's about flavor and sometimes it's not, but you don't, anything that's not necessary to what the story you're telling really shouldn't be there. That being said, your story doesn't necessarily have to have the thing that I think you can take out of that is, even if something happens accidentally, if it matters to the story, then that's okay. We are we're pretty similar in terms of tastes in general.
Yeah, it's just a thing where people with similar interests kind of end up being funneled together.
Yep. Well, that's not where we met. We met over cheese.
What?
Huh?
What are you talking about, cheese?
You taught me how to stock cheese.
Oh yeah. That's true.
Yeah. We met like a long time ago, but we didn't become friends until more recently when we like actually spent a lot more time together.
Yeah. Well, I don't think work is not a great place to just like have a casual conversation about writing. So that you gotta kind of actively work to get to that point.
I think that's both true and not true. But yes. I've totally had conversations with Andrew Pratt about Russian literature casually on couches and breaks.
Yeah, that's true. Break's a little different. When you're like working with someone, like piling stuff up or trying to organize what it is you're doing, usually you're not, or at least I'm not, in that kind of academic mindset. I kind of switch gears.
Yeah, no, I totally get that. I prefer working on my alone, by myself in those scenarios as well, so I don't get distracted by weirdness.
Well, it's not even that. It just feels like it's a different part of my brain that I'm using, and I kind of gotta hit the clutch and slam into that other different gear, and then I can think about that, and it's really tough to do both at the same time. And flipping back and forth, I lose a lot of torque, so to speak.
Yeah, I get that. I thought nerds were the new cool kids. And aren't most writers nerds? Isn't that a thing? Because I've met quite a few writers, and almost all of them are nerds. They're not necessarily geeks, but they are all nerds.
Boop, boop, boop. So what have you done in this story that like gives it flavor? What is where's the crunch in this thing? You've written anything? Because I haven't been reading it in detail. But
well,
I,
that's true. So
it's really hard to read because of the angle it's at.
Yeah, I know. But I can't really like, I'd have to like strap the camera to my body.
Yeah, that would be really tough.
I don't know if I'm at that point yet. Yeah, I have that conversation all the time. Usually people are pretty supportive, but yeah.
Well,
in that sort of like, oh, that's cool, man. You should do that. And I'm like, yeah, I'm gonna do it. Thanks.
Yeah, it feels like they asked a question and they were in no way prepared for the answer. Like they didn't even really know what they were asking.
Yeah.
Or I think the expectation with a lot of these people is more like, oh, I'm gonna make my business and, you know, do this and that, and like more concrete things is the expectation.
Yeah.
Whereas I know for me it's more nebulous than that. It's like, well, I wanna do art, man.
Do you remember, and I apologize to chat because you have no idea who I'm talking about, but do you remember Jason Blulow? Sam?
I mean, maybe? You know how bad I am with names.
He used to work in Delhi. And he used to sketch on his breaks all the time. He's a little bit older. He's probably about, probably late 30s now.
Oh, was he the one he had, like, the Matt Good quote on his arm?
I think so. He had kind of, like, that Matt Good, like, goatee... Like,
I think I know who you're talking about.
Yeah, anyway, he's a professional artist. Like, that's what he does now. And that's super inspiring. Well, I mean, that's super inspiring to me, in a weird way, because I don't think his art was great. Well, I don't.
No, I laugh because, like, you can think that, but if he's a professional artist, like, he's getting paid for that.
Yeah, well,
who are we to judge?
Well, that's the thing is, like, I don't particularly love his.
And if that's what he likes.
I don't particularly love his style, but I don't think it's necessarily not art, and I think. I see things from him every now and again because I have him on Facebook. I see things from every now and then about shows he's having, and the shows that he's at are super cool. Like, they're with a lot of other indie artists, and they're all really, really cool and academic and awesome and weird in that way. But yeah, I respect the hell out of him, and in a lot of ways, he's kind of my inspiration because he escaped, I guess. And did something that mattered, yeah. Especially later on in life, because he was much older than I am now, when he chose to make that decision.
Well, and that casual throwaway thing that you just said, he's doing something that mattered, is something that I have a hard time getting across to people.
Yeah.
When I say, well, I want to get a real job, I want to write, and they're like, what? You're doing a real job, but I don't feel like I do anything.
Yeah, it's something I've been coming to terms with a lot lately. With that, like, working a job to pay the bills so that you can write. But sometimes that's not enough. Sometimes you gotta take some chances and, you know, push for something more creative, something that maybe isn't necessarily a great job either, but allows you to work on the things that you can do in your spare time so you can become better. I hang out with a lot of artists, right? Like visual artists, and we're talking a lot of, like, working a graphic design job where, you know, you can flex the right muscles, but it's not necessarily, like, creative illustration and stuff like that. I agree with you entirely, Logan. What kind of stuff do you write? I write a lot of things. I write movies and books and stuff.
Yeah. That's the second most difficult question, I think, after what's your story about?
I don't know.
It's so hard to answer that.
Yeah. Yeah, people don't get it. Don't get in the way. Hey, baby girl, what's up? Not specifically about you, actually, Johnny. But you are an example of that, yes. I was thinking of Stevie and a few other things. Yeah, what's it about? the guys at work are hilarious because they always ask me about the novel I'm working on. And I haven't worked on that novel in over a year. It's like, oh, it's going fine, I guess. Working on some short stories right now. They mean well. They mean well. I'm actually happy that they remember that much, to be honest. It's kind of a nice thing. Even if it's not as nice as I would like it.
Well, the real key is just when you do eventually get published, you just leave a copy of it sitting in the break room table and never say a goddamn word. See if anyone notices.
Oh, man. I'm not going to lie. I really want to do a book signing.
You mean at work?
Yeah. Like one of those actual, like, press tour book signings that they do all the time?
Yeah.
Like come back and be like, hey, I'm a big shot, like...
Yeah, that would be very satisfying, I admit.
Yeah. Jason has told me that he wants me to do that, so I'm like, sure, no problem.
Yeah, I don't know. Maybe I'm weird and unrealistic in as much as I think my ultimate dream would be able to, like, give my right away. I think that's so much better, like, to just be able to... But, I mean, it's totally unrealistic because you need to get paid for something.
Yeah. I agree with you. It's a hard thing. I think the world in which we live in now, for artists especially, is a world where giving away art is kind of a thing. And the people who...
It's much more doable.
Yeah, the people who want to give back to you will. That being said, it's hard work, and it involves building a community and building a following and various other things. But I think it's doable.
Well, there's so many more opportunities and such a lower barrier for entry, given things as simple as Amazon self-publishing, where you can just copy and paste whatever .txt file you want into there and set your price.
Yeah.
And but then all the way up to Kickstarter or Indiegogo or any of those things, where if you have an existing following, you can leverage that to.
Well, I was thinking
something.
Patreon, to a certain extent.
Or Patreon, yeah. Patreon's a little different in that it's much less about creating a specific project and more about allowing you to start new projects, just in kind of be a bit more freeform.
That's really funny, Dry. I know exactly what that, how that goes.
Yeah.
We're all doing great here, baby girl. Yeah, Patreon is kind of like the new, well, I mean, literally in the name, it's the new patrons, right?
Yeah.
Of the Renaissance.
I think it's amazing that, you know, if you make something good and even if you've been giving it away for ages, there's a ton of people out there who definitely want to give you their money. They think it's so good.
Are you talking about The Martian again?
I know. Well, actually, I was thinking, well, that is certainly one example, although he didn't, Andy Weir didn't use Patreon, but I was thinking of things like the webcomics that I read all the time.
Yeah.
You know, those are put up whether you pay for them or not. But if you like it and you want to support that artist, you want to see more of it, give them a couple bucks a month. It's not much out of your pocket,
well,
most of the time.
Here's a more interesting example, but certainly on point and maybe a little ironic, Twitch.
Yep. Yeah. Following or subscribing to someone.
Yeah.
Giving them a couple bucks a month.
Yeah. For sure.
I know at least one streamer that I follow who makes enough money from subscriptions and from Patreon that they quit their job and they just stream full time now.
Yep. Well, I was going to say Stevie. Stevie used to work a UI design job. And now streams full time.
It's a brave new world we live in.
Yep.
Exciting time to be alive.
Oh yeah, for sure. Freelancing is such a thing now. And I know that's both a good and a bad thing, but in a lot of ways, I'm not going to be a partner of Twitch, I don't think. As much as I would love to use Twitch to support my writing, and that would be pretty awesome, I don't have the time right now in order to really put effort into doing that. Maybe in the future that would be a thing that I would do. But right now I'm cool with just doing Twitch for fun. Doing Twitch to have conversations about art. Learn stuff. Learn about other people. And hopefully impart something along the way. So yeah, that's why I'm on Twitch. Yeah, I don't think I'm going to be a partner. I only stream like once or twice a week, because that's all the time I have around my full-time job. I would like to change that. This week has been very eye-opening for me. Man, Sam, I've had a hell of a week. It's been awesome.
Well, I've just been jealously watching your stream notifications.
Yeah.
When I get them at work, and it's like, well, I guess I'm here.
Yeah.
Doing this thing.
That sucks, man. But
it's not good.
No. But yeah, like I'm more sure than I ever was that this is what I want to do. That I want to share my writing with the world. And I want to do this like full time. Not necessarily Twitch specifically. Well, I didn't mean Twitch. I meant if I could stream for a couple hours a day, that'd be awesome. And I could work on freelance stuff all along this on the side, kind of like Derek does. I'm trying to make that transition. I don't know if I've discussed this very much. I think I've mentioned it to you, Sam, but I'm actively looking for freelance jobs right now because I want to do more of this.
And I want to turn down that WWE writing job.
Oh man, I was. Yeah, I'm. That was such a cool job, but at the same time, I don't know, man. I don't know if I can handle it.
Da 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 da.
I said it to you, but yeah, there's a reporting job for WWE freelance that looked awesome and seemed like it would pay fairly well, like all right, and I would watch a lot of wrestling and do stuff. It was pretty neat. it was a reporting job though, but yeah. I don't know, like, I didn't know if I could handle it. I really, when I was talking to Sam about it and Terry and all them, if I could do, like, special features, like, if I could write about wrestlers in media and, like, wrestling video games and kind of branch out from just, like, watching SmackDown and giving write-ups, I would totally be in. I would love to analyze plot lines and talk about face heel turns and, like, all that kind of stuff. I would love to do that, but that wasn't the type of writer they wanted. And I didn't know if I could stomach watching that much SmackDown. Because as much as I like wrestling, I don't know if I like wrestling that much.
I feel like there's a like fear and loathing in wrestling opportunity there. Like, because there's so many layers to the distortion of reality that goes on. What parts of the story are real, what feuds are actually between people, and what has been scripted and what's being out just for drama. It would be fantastic to get inside there and see some of the reality and try and draw a narrative out of that and move between that real and fictitious and all the liminal places in between.
Did I ever tell you about that awesome wrestling webcomic I read once?
Probably.
I'll have to look it up, and if I do, I'll send it to you. But it was super sweet because it took this stance of like, what if wrestling was real, but not like a like everything is super serious and drama, but like off mat drama led to on mat drama, and on mat drama led to off mat drama, and it was super interesting, like the way that it played with that narrative of like what's real and what isn't, because at times it was like, oh yeah, no, this is just a play. Like our stable is this and we're doing like this thing, but other times it was like, why are you my friend? You're my friend, why are you betraying me? And it was super good. It was really legit.
Yeah, writing is a lot of work at this point.
Yeah,
but I don't know, maybe writing is like having a child. You know, it's real fun up front doing the writing part, the creating part, and then actually trying to hold that into something that's a useful part of society or a well-rounded individual is really tough and takes a lot more time.
Yep. Especially when you have all these rebellious artists who don't want to be a useful part of society.
Yeah, all those damn characters who just want to go and do their own thing. You gotta be like, no, character, you gotta get a job. You gotta get a degree. You gotta kill the siren. What the hell?
Yeah.
I hired you to kill the siren, and now all you want to do is be buddies with it? What is this?
Yep. That's pretty much how it goes.
Siren, why didn't you go to class? You just went and you sang at Greek people for a year. What is this?
Yeah, basically. Actually, I was playing around with that myth, where in my context of this story, the gods trap them at sea as punishment, and eventually, when the gods found that they actually loved the sea, they trapped them back on land, and it killed them.
I feel like there's a Promethean similarity here. Like they've been bound to this place and left to be eternally tortured.
Yeah. I mean, basically, that's kind of what it is, and that's why the song is so sad. Because in a lot of ways, they're wrongfully punished.
Yeah, I think that's the best way to build an antagonist, if that's... And that's not really who this character is, but I always love an antagonist who isn't some like mustache twirling evil villain.
Yeah.
You know, they, from their perspective, everything they're doing is legitimate, and even maybe from your perspective, what they're doing is legitimate. It just is totally counter to your interests.
Yeah.
I think that intersection of character motivations really create a compelling story, or a compelling conflict anyway.
Yep.
From which you can create a story. The other great thing about that is, at least the way that I write is I will, once I kind of resolve a conflict, I always want to say, okay, what other thing can I throw down this character's path and see whether they go right or left? And when you have two very different characters like this, you can see one zig and the other zag, and you know why. Or that can inform their characters and can be informed by their character.
Yeah, because in both these cases, we have two very different characters who have basically feel like they were turned into monsters as a punishment, almost. Like they didn't have a choice in being a monster. So Hyperinor is kind of like always rebelling, like conflicted with that, where he doesn't want to be a monster, but the Siren accepts it because she accepts her punishment. Because as much as it might be unjust, she still failed her mistress. So, you know, she kind of feels like she deserves it in a way.
Interesting.
Which is why I cut all those external scenes, because I kind of had that like epic story, like movie style story going along, where like, you know, he fights her and then gets convinced otherwise, and then they end up getting captured by the bad guy, the actual bad guys, and like there's a demon summoning ritual and blah blah blah. It's like, no, that's not interesting. Like that's run of the mill fantasy movie. What I want is I want to know, like, this conversation and how it changes them. That's what matters. That's what's interesting. And how they deal with being a monster, yeah, and like, and all those like intricacies, and how she convinces him to kind of change.
It'd be very interesting to pick that story up, you know, the epic movie story just after the final battle.
Yeah, I think of that all the time, where I would love to write us. There's a lot of movies I would like to write a sequel to. And not necessarily like a specific, like, I want to write a sequel to this movie, but like a spiritual sequel of like taking the end of that movie as a premise for another movie.
I mean more like, you know, the two gods fight and they manage to reach a standstill, and like where maybe that would be the end of the narrative in a movie, or like where one would come up on top. Like explore how they have to deal with, like, how does this personally impact them? Like, you know, they're both sitting on rocks on opposite sides of the battlefield, sweating and bloody, and like, how do they want to deal with that? Like, because I know a lot of times when you have that kind of rivalry, you almost come to respect your enemy as much or more as your allies.
Yeah.
So to see that kind of camaraderie of battle and of experience was really an interesting thing to explore.
I mean, that's kind of what made that's kind of what made Letters of Iwo Jima such a compelling film.
I don't think I could watch that.
Really? You should. You should. If you're gonna watch it, though, you should watch it with Flags of Our Fathers. They were made by Clint Eastwood around the same time, and they're better together than they are apart. Because they show the two different sides. There's like one from the American side and one from the Japanese side. But yeah, Letters from Iwo Jima stars, what's his face there? That guy who's in everything.
Ken Watanabe.
Yeah, Ken Watanabe. He's amazing.
Yeah, that guy's, he's in a shitload of stuff.
He's in everything. He's like, if you need a Japanese actor, he's in it.
Yep. Yeah, he is the Hollywood, like, archetype for a Japanese actor.
It's him and the guy from 47 Ronin.
He was in 47 Ronin, wasn't he?
Ken Watanabe? I don't know. I don't think he was. He was in The Last Samurai.
Maybe not.
Is that what you're thinking of?
Maybe that's what I'm thinking of. Yeah, the other guy, whose name I'm going to butcher... Hiroyuki Sanada. Maybe that's... No, he was... Yeah, he was in 47 Ronin.
Yeah, I think...
He, I remember from Sunshine, as Kanada, the captain of the ship.
Right. I think that's the guy I'm thinking of. Yeah, I think so. Yeah, that guy. That guy's the other, like, big Hollywood Japanese actor.
He is also very good.
Yes. Yes, he is. Sunshine was a great film.
I actually, as much as people complain about it having that weird turn at the end, I friggin' love that. That's kind of my favorite part, where it's like all this build-up, all this tension, and then you have this insane release, just like this whip-crack of madness at the end. And you never quite see the evil guy, because he's always silhouetted against the sun. So the sun is almost more the enemy than anything else.
Well, I think that's kind of the point of that movie, right? Like, the sun kind of is the enemy.
Well, the sun is this adversarial thing that they've got to wrestle with. Whether or not it's actively an antagonist is a different question.
Fair enough. It is trying to kill them.
What did you see, Kanada?
Sonata was in The Last Samurai as well.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, Google's doing some spooky stuff right now where it's like, oh, you searched for multiple actors. You're looking for the people from this movie.
Fair enough.
Like, it's totally separately from the result. It's like, hey, these last three people you searched were all in this film. This is what you're looking for, isn't it?
I love Google. So good at what it does.
Beautiful, beautiful AI.
The one that's doing the kind of the Hollywood Asian actor of today is Lee Byung-hee, who's a Korean actor who's been in like everything. Like, he was in Red and Red 2. He was in all the G.I. Joe films, the new ones. He's been in a bunch of stuff. Oh, sorry, not Lee Byung-hee, Lee Byung-hun, sorry. He was the Terminator in Genesis.
Jeez, I didn't even watch that movie. The last canon Terminator is the second one, as far as I'm concerned.
That's fair. Anyway, he's the Hollywood Asian guy right now. He's been in a ton of stuff. He's gonna be in the new Magnificent Seven remake, which looks so good. Well, I haven't seen any trailers, but the cast looks amazing.
Yeah, let's hope it's good. Man, they could fuck that up.
Yeah. But did you see the cast for it, Sam?
No.
It's Denzel Washington, Chris Pratt, Ethan Hawke, Vincent D'Onofrio, Lee Byung-hun, I don't know the other two guys, Peter Sarsgaard, Haley Bennett, Vinnie Jones. Like, that is a cast. That is a cast.
This is quite a cast. That's like Tarantino territory of the number of big actors.
Yep.
Yeah, Jesus. There's like no one in this who isn't huge.
Oh yeah, Matt Bomer, I know him. Luke Grimes, I think I know him. Oh yeah! This guy's awesome. Man, anyway.
It's terrific and tragic Tarantino territory.
Just such a great cast. I love Akira Kurosawa. I love The Seven Samurai. I love the adaptations of The Seven Samurai. There's a really cool one with a bunch of mech samurai in a cyberpunk Japan.
Yes, please.
Yeah, it's called Samurai 7. It's amazing. Actually, Netflix recommended the newest Netflix anime. Netflix original anime is a samurai Gundam story at a high school research facility, and I was like, so I'm watching this next week, right? Like, that's happening.
Sorry, I'm still looking for this Samurai 7. Here we go.
It's got a guy who wears pot-belly stove basically on him.
Oh my god, some of the images for this. This is great.
Yeah.
This is the good shit.
It's really cool. I really like that one. But yeah, Akira Kurosawa in general is awesome. Throne of Blood is a masterpiece. That's all I have to say.
Blood for the blood god. Skulls for the skull throne.
Well, yeah. Throne of Blood is a Shogun era retelling of Macbeth by Akira Kurosawa in black and white, starring Toshiro Mifune, the samurai actor himself.
That would be pretty great.
It was amazing.
I think that would translate pretty perfectly.
It was like word for word. It's basically Macbeth takes over the shogunate instead of being king. It's
well, yeah. I mean, the political situation is actually so similar.
Yep. And all this weirdness about Ronin and it's just the way he does it. It's so good. And Toshiro Mifune, for all of his reputation as like a samurai actor, is an amazing samurai actor. Like, he is a very good actor who only plays samurai.
You know, they typecast him as a samurai, but he totally plays an amazing samurai.
He does. He's a really good samurai. So yeah, the original Magnificent Seven, starring Yul Brynner, was a remake of it.
Yeah, it's the retelling of that same myth, or
yeah, because
epic story, I guess.
Well, I was gonna say because feudal Japan has a lot of similarities to the Wild West. There's been a lot of academic articles written on the similarities between the two. I mean, a samurai is basically the same as a lone gunman in the Wild West, right? Like, there's so many parallels.
There's some substantial differences, but yeah, there's a lot of similarities.
Historically there are a lot of differences, but it has that sort of isolation and kind of the other, right? Of being that one man against the world sort of thing.
Yeah, and I think the biggest thing that stands out for me is the Bushido code that goes along with being a samurai, even if you're a Ronin. Whereas if you're a Wild West lone gunman, you're just trying to get away most of the time, and you don't care about the rules. And in a lot of cases, it's because you don't care about the rules.
Right, but I was thinking of like the man with no name who kind of has his own honor code.
But yeah, that particular archetype, the man in black, the man with no name.
Yeah. You're right. Like, if you're talking like a rogue bandit gunman, yes. Yeah. Kirito Toshirô Mifune has been in 170 feature films.
That's a lot of movies.
He's done 16 with Akira Kurosawa.
Damn.
Yeah. But yeah, he's played a samurai a lot.
Well, I'd hope he's good after that much samuraiing. Like, you know, you'd be good at anything if you do it that much. That's your 10,000 hours of being a samurai.
Yeah. Well, I mean, they're talking about it here in the Wikipedia article on him. Clint Eastwood was among the first of many actors to adopt this wandering warrior persona for foreign films, which he used to great effect in his Western roles, especially The Man with No Name, where he plays a similar character to Mifune's Ronin with No Name role in Yojimbo.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Even his Dirty Harry movies are kind of similar. That character is kind of similar.
Yeah. For sure. There's definitely a lot of parallels to that. I've seen two of the five Dirty Harrys.
I think I've seen all of them. Maybe only four of them.
I only really like the first one. I don't know. Maybe the third or fourth would be better.
You mean like actually Dirty Harry?
Yeah, actually Dirty Harry.
That's not the first one.
Is it not?
Is that the first one?
I'm pretty sure that's the first one.
Wikipedia, tell me your secrets. Yes, it was. Yeah. It's weird because I think I'm most familiar with the Deadpool, the last one.
Okay.
And I think it's probably just because it is the most recent. So it was slightly more contemporary when I saw it.
Yeah. I didn't like the second one. I watched the second one. I thought it was mediocre. It didn't have...
Mediocre.
Well, it had that element of Dirty Harry being Dirty Harry, but it didn't have the weirdness and strangeness of the antagonist that the first one had.
Yeah. Dirty Harry had a really interesting and personal relationship between the detective and the criminal, which is something that it was very much trying to explore, and something that I think is really interesting.
Yeah.
And it kind of got lost under the action movie that they turned into.
Yeah, I think so.
So many good quotes that came out of those Dirty Harry movies. It's so memorable.
Yeah.
And so many things that are misquoted.
Yep. I mean, do you feel lucky, punk, being misquoted?
Yeah, never said that.
Nope.
He never said that. At all.
He called the guy a punk a lot. And he did say...
Well, he said, after talking about, like, do you know whether I shot five... times or six, he says, you gotta ask yourself one question. Do I feel lucky?
Yeah.
Well, do you, punk? And then
they kind of got shortened.
Well,
he
pulls
way.
The trigger.
Yep.
Well, he that character had such a...
That was such a throwaway moment, too. Like, they...
Yeah, it's not even part of the main plot.
Well, I guess it's not throwaway. It really establishes who the character is and what they're about. So it's actually really effective. It's just... It's such a weird moment of, like, at the beginning of the film, he, like, arrests this bank robber because he happens to be in the area. And, like, this whole thing plays out, and that's, like, the thing that people remember is that moment.
Yeah, well, exactly, and it informs who Dirty Harry is really all the way through those movies.
Yeah, totally.
He's the guy who's willing to take that risk, like, yeah, maybe I'll blow your head off, maybe I won't. Worst scenario, I don't blow your head off.
Yeah.
And of course,
he establishes himself as a risk taker. Night, Johnny.
Yes.
I'll talk to you later. Yeah, he establishes himself as a risk taker, which plays throughout that movie. Throughout the entire series, really, where, you know, he's not afraid to go against the grain if it's kind of the right thing to do.
Yeah, he'll totally use the law as long as it's useful for him, but as soon as it gets in his way, he just discards it.
Yeah.
That sentence. I don't like that sentence. He fought for money, and once he accepted a contract, he finished it. That's so clunky.
Yeah, I agree. His perspective doesn't really come out in it either. And I think this is super out of character as well.
Yeah, you need more of like a his word is his bond kind of thing there, I think.
Yeah, I agree.
So, I mean, I don't feel like these people would have spoken in terms of contracts. I mean, at least not in a mythological sense. It was more of a point of honor.
Yeah. I mean, mercenaries were totally a thing, right? Like.
Yes, but.
But it wouldn't be contracts. So
it would be, but they wouldn't think of it as. It wasn't the contract that was the important thing, I guess.
Yeah. I agree. And I think this is out of character.
Ourselves. Yeah, it's too. You're looking at it from a too modern perspective.
I found that a lot of the dialogue has been very modern in this, and I tried to change it. There was one line that I thought was like straight from a Sword and Sandals movie, and I was like, "Yes, this is the best line ever."
I shall smite thee.
Where'd it go? I just smell vanilla coming off these.
Your highlighters smell like vanilla?
No, the protein shake I spilled on them does.
Oh.
I'm Hyperinor of the Spartai. You've come to hire my sword, have you not?
Yeah.
I'm not saying it's good, I'm just saying it sounds very sword and sandally.
Yeah, it sounds like something from a trailer that you'd see, and then they'd cut away to him like swinging a sword or something.
Yeah. Cut this. I like this description, but I think it needs to go in a different place. It feels like he embraces his destiny a little bit too much for the kind of like hate he has for his own monstrosity.
Yeah, you really need to leverage that, I think, a lot more.
Yeah.
That mental dissonance that he's got between hating what he is and using it to his advantage.
Yeah. I agree. You agree entirely.
Like, again, I said it before, the Jerry of Rivia, the way he...
It's Rivertown.
Jerry of Rivertown, the way he frequently will play up the fact that he is a witcher and that he knows people are kind of afraid of that. So he can intimidate people or push them in directions because he knows their preconceptions.
He's almost as dangerous as the monsters.
From their perspective, yes.
Yeah. Well, I mean, but from our perspective, too, but yes.
Maybe, but he's not here to, you know, just murder a bunch of dudes. He doesn't kill people unless you pay him.
Yeah. Or they, like, disrupt...
Oh, they fuck with
him. Yeah, they disrupt him in some way in which he feels like vengeance is a proper course of action.
But even that has to be something pretty substantial.
Right.
Like, there's plenty of instances where he just shrugs things off like, wow, you are just some hater.
Yeah, oh yeah, totally. I'd be interested to know, and I suspect that this is the case, but I'd be interested to know if that perspective is heavily communicated in the book series. I assume it would be.
Yeah, but... and I've been looking for a good English version. I know some people, some other streamers that I've talked to who really like the books and who've read the books, and they said, in fact, it was actually this Finnish streamer who, like, I asked him, like, do you read it? What, is there a good translation? He's like, yeah, I read it in English, because the Finnish one is garbage, apparently. The best translations are actually the English ones.
That would make sense, because of the heavy English following, because of the games and stuff.
I think it was even before the games came out. There's just such a large English language market for books.
Well, I was going to say, I think it's hard to say because I don't know the book market well enough in other translated areas, but I feel like the English translation scene, a good translator is like a high commodity, right? And there's a lot to be said about good translators, and they get a lot of work. And I'm thinking of even, I can't remember his name, but that guy who won the Nebula for his translation of, I think, the Three Body Problem. Was that not it?
Yes, I'm pretty sure it was that guy.
Yeah, like he won a Nebula for his translation.
His translation is extremely good in that. And being
right?
Partway, two-thirds of the way through the second one, which is translated by someone else, it's not as good. And it's actually a little disorienting when you can see... something that was obviously the same word in Chinese that's now a different third word than what it was translated to in the first book.
Yeah, like, totally.
There's one term they call it a flying star in the original or in the first book, and then they call it a shooting star or something. It's something slightly different, and it's hard to make that connection.
Yep. I mean, I see that all the time in the Scanlation community. Where, you know, you'll have one guy who's pretty decent and has a good proofreader and does a good job, and then, like, that translator will have real-life stuff, so he doesn't work on the next couple. So somebody else comes in, and they're much, much worse. Or they translate things differently, and it's confusing. Like character names or different things, you know?
Yeah, especially if you're translating from something that doesn't use the same alphabet, man, spelling gets crazy weird and bad.
Yeah, and names, and like the thing about names are so important in Japanese literature. Like what a name means and what it stands for and how it's written matter. Because there's lots of like weird like. Translate like weird mispronunciation jokes where someone will read a name wrong because that's what the characters could be read at, and it's like a joke, right? Like,
yeah.
we don't have that
it's
in English
like
in the same
English.
Way.
Well, you could totally spin it as like, you know, putting a different emphasis on the words in English where you can produce a very different sound,
right? But how do you communicate that really effectively in writing?
It's not easy.
No. It's something like my favorite example is there's a Key and Peele sketch about a supply teacher who the supply teacher is from the ghetto and he goes to like a prep school, so he pronounces everybody's name like they're from the ghetto.
Yes, I've seen that and it's amazing.
It's
and
hilarious.
All students have like no idea what's going on.
Yeah. But that's kind of what that is, right? Like it's that weird like interpretation.
Well, it's that was actually a beautiful exploration of regional accents.
Yeah.
Like he's not wrong, you know. If you were in a different place, that is totally how those words would be pronounced.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, it's something that you can really only communicate well with sound, I think. Be hard to write that differently.
With the Latin alphabet, probably. Yeah, it doesn't lend itself to that.
I love this line, but I don't know where I should put it.
Oh, typo.
Where?
Persephone was out mistress.
Yeah.
Yeah, speaking of translations, actually, I just was watching, I think, well, it's the third to last episode of a Let's Play that I, Chip Cheese'em Let's Play. You know I love Chip Cheese'em.
I know you love Chip Cheese'em.
And it was Zone of the Enders, which is a Hideo Kojima game that he made long in the like mid-90s. And that game tanked because they ran out of money, or they just chose not to spend the money on a proper translation. So they got someone to translate it extremely literally.
Right.
And there are huge segments that make absolutely no sense. You can tell what they're sort of going for. But like at one point, someone says the main character Dingo says he quotes someone, and the other person says, "Who's second hand?" And it just makes no goddamn sense. It's like they're clearly trying to say, "Who are you quoting? You know, who's that second hand from?" But they chose to just translate the words literally instead of localizing it properly.
Yeah, translating is an art. I don't know if I told you this, but I did some work in the Scandinavian community for a while when I was trying to work on my skills, like doing proofreading, and I actually did some translating from French, and doing translating from French wasn't a huge deal for me because I graduated immersion and all that. So I used Google Translate and then I edited it based on how I interpreted the words and stuff like that, and it came across fairly well. But I was proofreading the hardest manga to proofread ever. It was a manga called Mao Mao Yusha, and there's a bunch of different variants of it. But basically, the entire point of the manga, which I love the idea of, was everyone was named after what they were. So, like, the hero was literally named Hero in Japanese. And the Demon Queen is literally Demon Queen, and there was a young merchant and an old merchant, and they were named that. And it got really, really weird because I couldn't deal with the way that the language was. Like, it was like this weird, like, political economic drama of, like, fantasy, epic fantasy stuff. And it was so hard to deal with. Because it dealt with all these really, really tough concepts that the translator couldn't necessarily explain to me. Because they weren't, like, readily available to me. It sucked.
Yeah.
It sucked bad.
It's hard to translate. It's almost possible to translate allusions to things that you don't know what they are.
Yeah. Well, and that was just a very high-handed, like, high-concept book. And, like, I feel like any translation of it was going to be bad, no matter who translated it. Because it's so... There's so many things that you're trying to communicate in every single bubble. And it was all dialogue. Like, there wasn't any action scenes. It was, like, all dialogue. People talking about economics and people talking about plans and stuff. Like, it was crazy. I think they dropped it not long after I left because, like, it was too hard. Which sucked because the parts that were done, like, were really good. Like, it seemed like a really awesome manga, but it was just, unless you're getting paid to do it, why would you do something like that? Like, beats me, man.
Yeah, there was, There was one of those in the Dark Forest where there was this line, someone said, this is like when that deity, and I can't remember what the name was, separated the earth from the heavens, and I'm like, well, I have no context for this. I don't know what myth this is. I don't recognize that deity name, but like, it's very clearly a creation myth. But, like, I can't appreciate the significance of this guy who's clearly really shocked.
Yeah, that's when I knew I had made it. When I was watching dramas and I got their references to other dramas, it was like, okay, I'm good now. I've watched
yeah,
enough.
No, you actually
I'm
understand.
Part of this world.
Well, that I think is a sign of good world building when you can integrate that into the world where you can make reference to things without having to explicitly explain them.
Yeah. Oh yeah, totally. I was talking about Borges yesterday. I read some out loud, and I love the way that he does that, where everything is a reference. Like, it's like a cryptic literary shorthand of metaphor and...
Yeah, that's an impressive thing to be able to pull off.
Yeah. He's an impressive writer, and I'm reading a translation from Spanish. Because he's an Argentinian writer. But yeah, I was gonna say most of the translations were published while he was still alive, so I believe most of them, like almost all of them, were done with him there, sort of thing, like translating with him. Which, if you can do that's the best way.
Definitely, because then at least you can get, you can be informed of the intent of the original writer, so you don't. Mistranslate,
yeah,
or misconstrue things,
especially something as academic as that, where like the language matters, the choices matter. Hello, FF42. I'm working on a short story I started on stream approximately 8 weeks ago. I only work on it on stream though. I don't work on it off stream, so my timing on this is actually really good. I think it comes down to what was it? I calculated it out. I think it's like 40 hours maybe I've worked on this total, which is pretty good. It's actually about a siren. Okay, so it's about a mythical Greek hero or mercenary who has been hired to kill a siren, and it's about exploring what it means to be a monster, because they're both mythical monster types. There was a whole thing about a demon summoning ritual and a bunch of stuff like that, but I actually ended up cutting that for the most part. It still informs the story, but it's mostly gone. Because I realized that the conversation about monsters and their conversations with each other mattered a lot more. So it got a little bit shorter, but it's more effective. It is 9:55, Sam.
It is. Yeah, how long are you going to go? Are you ending at 10?
I think so. I've pretty much only been doing 3-hour episodes. I kind of like that time. 3 hours. I think more than that is a little much.
Yeah, for a single sitting or if someone's watching the VOD, that gets pretty long.
Yeah. So yeah, for those of you just tuning in, this is my good friend and moderator, MC Pepper Pockets, also known as Sam. He was joining me to kind of be a audio distraction from me sitting staring at words for 3 hours. And also kind of just disperse some conversations about writing and what we both think and the way we interact with it. And also about movies and games and random stuff.
All the different kinds of storytelling.
Yep. So yeah, I'm gonna finish this page real quick, like get it done in the last 5 minutes. I only have 2 paragraphs left. I think that's okay.
I don't know. I think you need to pare down those questions.
The question, yes. I meant the line about, I thought this one was okay, but I could be wrong.
Oh. Yeah.
I think that's okay. It might need a little bit of a rewrite, but...
How much is this ancient Grecian character speculating about placebo effect?
I don't know. Not a ton. But then I kind of repeat the kind of same thing here, so repetition.
Yeah.
And I'm pretty sure this is already implied, so I don't need it. Yeah. I need to work a little bit on how I want to tell the myth of the sirens, or the Ovid version of the myth. Specifically...
You mean you're just gonna...
Sorry.
You're gonna readapt it?
Well, I already did. But I just like, what details am I missing? What details are important? Is there a better way to tell this story? Like... Right now it says, one morning when we woke, she was gone. It's like, is there something else there that can make it more interesting? Like, what details do I know that might be missing? Or might be relevant to the telling of the tale? But yeah. All right. So... I finished that page. Excellent. That's page 11 of 18 that I finished. Editing takes a long time. Especially when you're talking about other things, but I feel like just me like staring at the page is not as interesting.
I think this has made it all go a little quicker.
Yeah.
Feeling.
Yeah. I think so too. So yeah, gonna close it out for tonight. I will go to the big camera. Here we are. Wow, I look really sweaty. It's hot in here. Lights, man. My name is Brendan. This is Accidental Origin, the weekly writing web show. The last week, this is the 8th day in a row I've streamed. I did a whole drafting week where I drafted the first draft of that story. And can I say draft any more times in one sentence? I think not. I had a great week. I wrote like 3,500 words. I edited most of it. I think the story is really good. I think it's got quite a bit of potential. There's work left to be done, and I'm going to keep working on it on stream over the next couple of weeks to finish it off. hopefully. But I will keep you informed of my plans for that, for sure. Anyway, a big thank you to Sam for joining me and all of you for hanging out. But that's it for tonight. So, bye. Say your goodbye,
bye.
Sam. All right. Oh, yeah. And just before I go, if you want to check out my website, I have all the VODs and documents, show notes, drafts, and all that on there. As well as check me out on Twitter, and feel free to send me a message about what you think or if you have any questions or anything like that. So yeah, take care all. Bye-bye.